And then Valerie Messenger also, she had 150 points, so she only lost. So great job, I mean, that's pretty tough. And next time when we do prizes, the top winners will get prizes, but then everybody else that comes gets prizes for finishing the challenge, so stick with us, because it's fun. All right, so teams, the losers, I'm gonna start at the bottom, which they are, go figure. The losers had 92 points, and these are averages. 92, married to the loser, no, these aren't averages.
These are the averages added together.
Married to the losers, 99 points. The kid chasers, 107. There's a bunch of individuals without teams, and I always kind of throw those in there, so the individuals were 121. The fit fat ladies, the fit fab ladies, were 124. The IDK group was 126. The blondes were 132. The unrepentant thinners, 145, and the rat pack was 155. So you guys get to come get your gloves now.
Okay.
Yeah, your team. Or you can have the case. So we're gonna do a quick in-class challenge. The winner will get a pillow.
This is Brittany Bingaman. She is a family consumer science extension.
What do they call this?
County faculty agent, she does what I do in St. George, in Washington County. And her specialty is nutrition, she's a registered dietitian. And she's got some good ideas on how to eat better and some mindfulness, which is kind of a big deal. So we're gonna let her present to you, and she was good enough to come up, and even though it was really warm in St. George, she had to come here.
I know, I was not prepared, I broke out the spring clothes today, and then decided to come up to Beaver, so it's about 85 degrees in St. George, so. Well, thank you for having me, I appreciate Cindy asking me to come speak. So, I am gonna talk about something a little bit different tonight. So yeah, like Cindy said, I'm Brittany Bingaman, I'm the FCS person like Cindy in Washington County. But I'm gonna talk about something maybe a little bit different tonight, when we're talking about health and wellness. So, we're gonna talk about our internal cues, what kind of signals and what kind of things we can use for like our own internal wisdom to help us guide us with eating, which maybe, it's really kind of common sense stuff, but a lot of times it's stuff that we don't really think about. And then, so these are just some of the things that I'm gonna talk about. And then I'm gonna talk about how mindfulness relates to being able to listen to your internal cues to help guide eating. So, all right, so what are some, I know you all are in a health and wellness challenge in a class, so what are some traditional things you think of when you're trying to improve your health and wellness? What are some things that come to mind? What are things you've learned about so far?
Background sugars.
Okay.
Or water.
Water, stretching, exercise, what else?
Fruits and vegetables.
Yes, right? All of those great things, right? We may think about like, maybe cooking more, or learning cooking skills, or just kind of think about nutrition in general, right? So these are all great, like healthy habits and things that we can think about when we want to improve our health and wellness. Here are some of the things that you mentioned, right? Exercise goals, taking a cooking class, planning out your menus, maybe grocery shopping, planning ahead of time, things like that. Those can certainly help us with our food choices. Learning about My Plate, have you talked about My Plate in here? Right, so, and this is nutrition guidance from the USDA about how to create a balanced meal, right? How to eat in a balanced way that's gonna fuel our bodies and give us all the nutrients we need from eating from all the different food groups. So, these are all great things to keep in mind when we're trying to think about health and wellness. But, another thing, another tool that we have that we often don't think about is internal cues that we have inside of our bodies. So how many of you have children? Do you have children? So you've all, if you have children, you've all had a baby at one point, right? So what do babies do when they're hungry? Cry. What do they, how do you know when they've had enough to eat? They just stop, right? So babies are what we call intuitive eaters, right? They naturally know, you don't have to tell a baby to think about, you know, are you really hungry? You know, a baby's gonna let you know if they're hungry, right? Like they're gonna cry, you're gonna know they're hungry, they're gonna let you know when they're full, right? So we all start off that way, and a lot
food is reward.
Yes, exactly. That's a big one for kids too, right? Like that's how kids can kind of unlearn those natural cues, right? So because you begin to like associate, well, you know, if this is a reward or whatever, and so then you're just more focused on that than the food as nourishment for your body, right? What else? So external guidance, right? Like, and that comes in a lot of forms, right? So for kids, and then that's an example, but you know, for us, like advertising and things like that, and just, you know, portion sizes, we're gonna talk all about that. But these are all things that as we get older, they start to interfere with those natural signals. And it may seem really complex, but a lot of times people don't take the time to try to like tune into what's going on in their body. I'm sorry, it may seem really simple is what I meant to say, but a lot of times people don't take the time to tune into what's really going on in their body to kind of see what their body's needing. All right, so this is super simple, but it's a gas gauge, right? So when your gas gauge is on empty, what does that mean? It's on empty, right? Mine is on empty, and I'm not familiar with the area, so I was told there's a gas station right up the road, so that's good. But yeah, so when our gas gauge is on empty, what does that mean? We need to go get gas, right? We need to fuel up. So hunger and fullness is your body's gas gauge. I mean, this is so simplistic, right? But it's just that we don't often think about this. So, or a lot of people don't often think about this. So when we're over there on that left side, when we're down towards E, that means we're really low on fuel, right? And we need fuel, we need energy that's in the form of calories in our body to fuel our bodies and to, you know, the glucose to go to our cells and really give us the energy we need. And then we have over on the other side when we're full, right? So our body has this same signal system. So it's a system of hormones in our body. We have the hormone ghrelin, which we produce, our stomach, it comes from our stomach, and it's produced when our stomach is empty, saying, like, you're on empty, you need actual fuel, right? And then we have the hormone leptin, which comes when we're full, and that's a signal that goes to our brain that tells us we're full. Does anybody know how long it takes those fullness signals to reach our brain, like when we're eating? How long does it take to?
Like a half hour, 20 minutes.
Yeah, like 20 minutes, right? So that's what people say, but it's probably different for, you know, for different people. But the point is that if you're eating your whole meal in 5 minutes, are you giving that signal time to go to your brain to tell you that you're full? No. So, okay. So the point of me going over this is to explain that hunger is really a physical sensation in our body. It's like feeling cold, feeling tired, feeling thirsty, having to go to the bathroom, right? Like these are all like physical signals in our body that are originated like in our, they're signals that come from down here, right? Not signals that come from our brain. So that's a different type of hunger. But physical hunger is a sensation in your body that then travels up to your brain to tell your brain that you're actually hungry. So what does hunger feel like to you? How do you know you're hungry? When you feel physical hunger, what does it feel like?
Empty stomach?
Like an empty feeling? What else? Or could be feel, sound, what, like how do you know you're hungry? What does it feel like? Yeah, you can have like a rumbling in your stomach, right?
I get really cranky.
Yes. Hangry, right? Yeah. So some people feel like a dip in their energy. Like if they're working or something, they just feel like all of a sudden they feel really tired, or they just have like an energy low. Like they need energy, which is what food is, right? So, or some people even get like a little lightheaded or something, you know? So these are all sensations, but what happens is a lot of times if we're, you know, it can go both ways. So if we're eating while we're distracted, we're missing those signals that we may be full. Just like if we're just constantly busy and on the go, we may be missing those signals that we're actually hungry and our body needs fuel. Okay. All right. So we talked about physical hunger. So that's what I just explained, which was that physical sensation in our body. But there are other types of hunger that we experience that come from here, come from our head. So I haven't broken up. People that talk about this topic there's all different categories. They call them head hunger, you know, different things. But I have them broken into three categories. So I have on the left, physical hunger, and then in the middle, environmental hunger. Does anybody have an idea of what could be an example of environmental hunger?
Stressing when my coworker pulls out a bag of candy and then I want to eat candy.
Because it's right there, you see it, it's in your environment, exactly. or like going to the checkout line at the grocery store and seeing the Snickers bars that are right there in line next to there, or you know, TV commercials, right? Like that's an example. And then what you just said was, what did you just say?
Stress eating.
So that might be more over into the emotional hunger side, right? So that's when we eat, and when people say emotional hunger, and they think, you know, they think, oh, it's eating when you're so sad or when you're really lonely. But really, emotions are, you know, those are emotions, but so is stress, so is anxiety, so is, you know, nervousness, all those things that we experience a lot of times on a daily basis that can also trigger us to want to eat, right? So I have a little quiz for you. It's kind of simplistic, but it's just, we're going to go over because I get tired of listening to myself talk. So we're going to ask you some questions. All right. So I'm gonna read a couple of statements, and I want you to tell me which category each of them goes in. All right, the first one. It's 11:30 a.m. and I ate breakfast at 7 a.m. My stomach is growling. Physical, right? Probably. And some of these are a little subjective. I mean, you don't know. Like, you don't know what that person ate. Maybe they had steak and eggs or something and they're not hungry. You know, we don't know. But, okay, so I am on my way to the movie theater and I start thinking about popcorn.
Right.
Environmental, right? Associating the movies, and sometimes this can be just thoughts, right? Or memories of things, like, oh, I had this last time I was here, so now I want it again, right? Okay, it's 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and I think I'm hungry. What did I have for lunch? A small salad with light dressing and a pear. I'm having trouble concentrating. Probably physical. I mean, again, it kind of depends on the person, but that's a pretty light lunch, a small salad and a piece of fruit, right? There's no protein, there's no fat in that, so probably you're going to be hungry fairly soon. All right, I just had the cheese and crackers I brought to work for a snack. I'm reading over these reports, and I think I need another snack. Maybe emotional, right? Like, I'm bored, I just need something, some kind of stimulation, right? I've had a long day at work, I'm filling up at the gas station, and I noticed the Snickers bar at the checkout. Environmental, right? Okay, I'm watching TV and there's a commercial for cheesecake. Now I really want some cheesecake. Environmental. I just had a fight with my daughter. I'm really upset. I want a snack. Emotional. And then the last one, I just walked into the movie theater and I smell the fresh popcorn. Yeah, environmental, right? Okay, so the point I'm trying to make here is that those are that are over on the left-hand side are the actual physical hunger, meaning your body needs fuel, and that once you eat food, then that hunger is going to be satisfied, right? Like, you start off hungry, you're physically hungry, you eat, and when you're done eating, you feel physically full. Whereas the ones on the other side, the environmental and emotional, are those types of hunger that originate from here, right? So those aren't the kind that your body's not really needing fuel. It's triggered by something else. So how do you know the difference? So kind of what I just discussed. So on the left, the physical hunger, those sensations in your body, they start off gradual and they get more intense the longer you've gone from your previous meal. So maybe you ate breakfast at 7, around maybe 10 or 11, you start to get a little hungry, then you wait till 12, and it's just gradually getting stronger, right? And most people get hungry about every 3 to 4 hours, but that's a generalization. It depends on the person and it depends on what you had at your last meal. Like we said earlier, if you have a meal, like a big meal, something that has protein and fat and things like that in it, you're probably going to stay full longer than if you just have something with like carbohydrates or, you know, a small, you know, something small. So, you also, with physical hunger, a lot of times you're just kind of hungry and you kind of, there's a few things that sound good. You could, you know, whatever you have available may work for lunch or something like that. And then it goes away when you eat. So when you eat, that hunger is satisfied. You're no longer hungry anymore. But then on the right, the other types of hunger, a lot of times those that originate from our head, those come on suddenly. So like all of a sudden you see something and you feel hungry, or you just, you know, you're working on something, you feel bored or you feel stressed, and all of a sudden, you know, you just want something to eat. So that can be a clue. If it comes on really suddenly, that can be a clue. Like, maybe I need to tune in and see what type of hunger this really is, if I'm really physically hungry. And then the second, and then also a lot of times it's a desire for specific food. So maybe you like I said, you saw a commercial, you saw something, and then it's just like, you just want that one food, right? And nothing else. And then it doesn't go away with you when you eat. Because if you weren't physically hungry and then you eat, nothing's changed, right? So you're not somebody, there's so many people who, you know, write books and stuff on this topic, but this one lady, she's a psychologist, and she has something called the Apple test, and her test is, if you feel that sensation, and you feel like, I'm hungry, I want that cupcake, or I want that cookie, or something like that, if you ask yourself, do I want an apple? If the answer is, yes, I want the apple, then you probably are really hungry. But if the answer is, no, I don't want the apple, then you're probably just having that desire for that food, but it's not physical hunger. Unless you really don't like apples, and then you can get something else, you know? But, okay. So a lot of times when people are, if this is something people are interested in, I'm working on and kind of trying to tune in to their bodies and detect their hunger and fullness, a lot of times there's lots of dietitians and, you know, different people, doctors and different people that use hunger and fullness scales. And it's a pretty simple concept, but again, just something that we don't always think about. So this is just a numerical scale. There's a bunch of different versions you can find. And if you're interested, I brought a handout that has a version of this in it. So this one is pretty simple. It goes from on the left is a 1, and so that would be extremely hungry. And then on the right would be a 10, and that would be like uncomfortably extremely full. There's some that go like -2 to +2, -5 to +5. There's all kinds of different ones. But so this one on the left-hand side is that way too hungry. So you're getting to the point where you're just famished. What happens when you let your body get to that point? When you're just overly hungry, what happens?
Anything,
right? It's very difficult to make a conscious decision about what would be a nourishing food to put in my body, because your body is just like in that survival mode, right? Like, I'm just gonna grab whatever's there and whatever's quick energy, right? It's hard to plan in that state. And then you have on the other side the 10, which is uncomfortably full. So that's like Thanksgiving full, right? Like, you just don't even think you want to look at food for the next 2 days, you know? So the point is neither one of those points are very comfortable. It's not comfortable to get your body down to like starving, you need anything, and it's also not comfortable to get to that fullness point where you're so full you feel uncomfortable, or, you know, the thought of food makes you feel sick, you know? So this is a tool that people can use to kind of tune into their own body and see what works. And it's not a right or wrong thing, and it's not something to use to say, oh, I messed up, like I let myself get too hungry, or I got too full, and, you know, it's not anything like that. It's just a tool to use to kind of like see where you are and just experiment and see, like, where does it feel good for me to start eating? Like, if I start eating at this point, at what point am I hungry, but like I can make a conscious decision about what would be a nourishing food to put in my body and, you know, and make that decision and eat? And then where do I want to stop, where I feel satisfied but not like overly full? So most people feel, like on this type of scale, most people feel comfortable starting at like a 3. So you're just hungry. You're hungry, so you're having those physical sensations, like maybe some stomach growling or something like that, but you're not to that point of just wanting to eat anything. And then most people feel comfortable stopping when they're like a 6 or 7. So they feel satisfied, they feel like they're no longer hungry, their stomach is not empty anymore, but they're not at that point where they're like feeling uncomfortable. But again, it's just something, am I off the camera? I move around a lot. It's just something to use that people can use as a tool to kind of see what works for them. And if they, sometimes people like to do it for a little while and just kind of play with it and see, like, you know, experiment and see, you know, I don't know, I guess what works for them and, you know, as far as their comfort. So the second thing that's another internal cue that people can tune in to kind of help them guide their eating is really truly thinking about satisfaction with food. When you think about foods that are satisfying, what comes to mind? What comes to mind? A steak? Okay, what else? I know for me, this may be a weird food, but like I think of like avocados or like nuts or things like that where they're still nutritious foods, but they're like dense foods, right? And like if you notice that if you have like a, you know, a salad or you have something like that and you add like some nuts or some cheese or some avocados or something like that, you're gonna feel like a lot of times when you eat that, you feel like this was like a good meal, right? Like I'm not like still wanting something else after I get done eating. Whereas if you just had like a green salad or something like that, you might feel like, oh, I'm gonna go look for something else to eat, right? So what? Along those same lines, what happens when you do try to make, like, I guess make or truly satisfying in the first place, you might have stopped there. Does that make sense? So I like this quote. This is Evelyn Tribole. So she's a dietitian that's written this book called Intuitive Eating. That's it's a popular book. So it's been around for a while. But I like this quote. It says, "Don't settle. If you don't love it, don't eat it. And if you love it, savor it." And it's really just about like thinking about what kind of choices you can make that are gonna feel satisfying for you. And like I said, a lot of times when we do that, we end up eating less or eating more in line with what our body needs than if we're choosing things that are not satisfying. So what are some things that, what are some questions you could ask? Like thinking about what you really want, thinking about different tastes of food, right? And thinking about different textures of food and things like that. So at the bottom, I have something about a study that was done in four countries. And this was a study, it was done in 1999, so a while ago, but they just looked at like eating habits in different countries. And it was just like an observational study, so they were just looking at habits. There's no like predicting of anything, but they looked at four different countries. They looked at the US, they looked at Japan, Belgium, and France. And what they found was the people that in the US were the most likely to report like trying to eat for like diet reasons, right? Like picking foods based on that reason. But at the same time, they were also the least likely to report that they actually ate healthy. So they were more worried about food, but they actually ate less healthy in the long run. Which country do you think ranked pleasure and satisfaction the most important in their eating? The ones I just named.
France.
Why would you say that?
Well, they're kind of that kind of people.
Right.
I mean, that's like kind of their personality.
Yeah.
They savor everything.
Yes.
They are.
Yes, exactly.
You know, all different kinds of food.
Yes. So yes, that's exactly what happened. So the Americans were more concerned about what they ate, but they actually ate less healthy. Whereas the French made food choices more for like satisfaction and pleasure, and they actually were healthier than the Americans. So the thing is that, and again, the researchers couldn't like prove anything from that study. They were just giving people surveys. But the idea there is that, yes, if maybe there is something to learn from like thinking about people, like taking the time to savor your food and really enjoy your food and versus just like eating on the go and things like that. What are some of the things, and we've talked about this a little bit already, but what are some of the things that get in the way of us listening to those internal cues? We've already talked about this a little bit.
Timing?
How so? Whether you're hungry or not. What else? Yes, distraction. Okay, so here's some mindless eating and distraction. So I'll go ahead and put these up here. So there is this researcher, his name is Brian, his name is Brian Wansink, I think, and he is, he's at Cornell University. So he studies mindless eating, which is the opposite of mindful eating. So he studies mindless eating, and what he says mindless eating is eating in response to all these environmental factors that we have. So eating, some of them we've already talked about, right? Eating because food is there, because you see food. Like people have a meeting at work and they bring in donuts, and then you feel like you need to eat a donut, right? Food availability, package sizes, and restaurant portions. How does that impact us?
We pay for it, so you might as well
eat all of it. Right.
Little chips, you think, well, that's a bag of chips, but sometimes if you read the serving size on the back, it's two servings in a bag. And
right.
The calories are related to the size of the serving, but
not
if you
the
eat the whole
bag.
Bag, you're eating more than you think.
Exactly, yes. So he talks about how when we go to a restaurant and we see these portion sizes, it influences what we think is normal. We think, oh, it's just one bowl of something, right? Like it's just one bowl of soup, or it's just one plate of pasta. This must be a normal amount to eat, right? But actually, it's really not. And it's actually portion sizes have increased a lot over the years. He says that, for instance, in restaurants, portion sizes have doubled have increased more than 250% since 1970. So it's just like these restaurants and things like that, they're dictating like what we think is normal. Like we see it and we think, well, this must be a normal amount of food to eat, when really it actually may be a lot more than our body actually needs, right? So this, I thought this was really interesting. So I don't know that the name, I don't think the name of that is right, but it's essentially it was a bottomless soup bowl study that he did, the same researcher. So he split people into two groups. He gave one group of the people a regular bowl of soup to eat, and then he gave the second group a self-refilling bowl of soup. So it had a little tube under the table, and it refilled the soup gradually. So the people did not realize that the bowl was refilling itself. Now, I don't know how they did this. Everybody always asks me that. I'm like, I don't know. But somehow they did it slow enough that the people couldn't tell that it was happening, right? But so they had these two different groups. And at the end, which group do you think ate more soup? The refilling soup, right? That group of people ate 73% more soup than the other group. But the really interesting thing is they surveyed the people afterwards and they asked them how full they were after they ate. Both groups ranked themselves the same. They both thought they were the same level of fullness. And what the researchers concluded from that was that people are judging their fullness based on what they see that they're eating, right? Because the people whose bowl refilled, they didn't realize it. So they just assumed, oh, I just ate one bowl of soup, so I'm this level of fullness, right? When in fact they had almost eaten twice as much as the other group. So I thought that was really interesting. So his point in saying that is that the environment really does impact how, like, our, you know, how much we eat. Other things, we talked about this a little bit earlier, but other things that can get in the way of eating. So just like stress, and I talked about earlier how, like, emotions, we think of like these really intense emotions, but it could be just like day-to-day stress, right? Like boredom, anxiety, like, you know, all of these different types of things. Lack of self-care. I have like a bunch of different versions of this presentation. In another one, I talk about self-care and how as a dietitian, you think, why in the world are you talking about self-care? But a lot of times when you talk to people, if they're not taking care of themselves in other areas of their life, that translates over to their eating, right? If they're not getting enough sleep, you all have talked about that, right? If they're not just like doing, like taking care of themselves in an emotional way, like with social connections and things like that, then it's easier when you get stressed or when you feel anxious to turn to food to kind of help with that. So, and then negative thoughts and things like that. Okay, so one thing I want to point out before we go on is that normal eating isn't perfect. And when we're thinking about like tuning into hunger and fullness and things like that, and we're going to talk about mindfulness in just a second, but nobody does it perfect. Nobody only eats exactly when they start to get hungry and exactly when they start to get full, right? Everybody eats. Sometimes they may, you know, let themselves get too hungry. Sometimes they may eat past the point of fullness, right? That's all normal. Like, we're not machines. We're eating, you know, eating is it's a behavior, not a science, right? So, and the same thing, you know, to say that sometimes we eat when we're not physically hungry. Can anybody think of, like, a occasion or, you know, a time when maybe someone would choose, like, they know they're not hungry, but they just choose to eat? Yes, or like a wedding or something like that, where it's like, okay, you have wedding cake, and you may think, you know, I'm not really hungry, but I'm going to eat this piece of wedding cake, right? Or another example would be like if you go on vacation and maybe you go to a restaurant and you're not going to be back there for another year, so maybe you think, I'm just going to eat my favorite dessert even though I'm not really hungry, right? But the difference is, we're going to talk about this with mindfulness. It's like having that awareness. Like, it's okay to sometimes do that, right? Like, sometimes we're going to make a decision that I'm not physically hungry, but I'm choosing to eat this food, and that's okay. It's when people do it kind of like unconsciously and they don't realize that they're doing it, or they do it all the time. Like, every day at 3:00, I need to have this because, you know, even though I'm not hungry, because it helps me get through the day or something like that. That's when sometimes it can be problematic for people, right? So the idea is that it's not a perfect situation. It's just, and we're going to talk about mindfulness in a minute, it's just kind of a way to tune in so that people are more aware of when they're doing it, and then they can make a decision. Is this something that I want to do, or is it something that maybe now that I'm aware of it, I want to change? And this is a definition, a dietitian, it's from 1983, so it's very old, and people still use this, but it's a definition of normal eating, and her definition, her name is Ellen Satter, and her definition is normal eating is eating mostly when you are hungry and stopping mostly when you are full. But sometimes it's eating for other reasons outside of hunger or eating more or less than your body truly needs. And that's okay sometimes, but it's about listening to your body and learning to tune into your body. And then, like I said, with awareness, you can decide, is this something I want to do, or maybe do I want to do something a little bit differently? All right, so I have mentioned this several times that we're going to talk about mindfulness. So this is one strategy that people can use to kind of tune into those internal cues. So I think you all have already talked about mindfulness. Have you talked about mindfulness or meditation or both? Okay, so mindfulness can be like a more formal practice, right? It can be like meditation. So it can be like a yoga class or meditation where you're really like dedicating a set amount of time to focus on your mind and focus on your thoughts. And, you know, a lot of times you can do like a guided meditation or something like that. But it can also be like something more informal, like just a check-in throughout the day to kind of tune into how your body's feeling. Like some people do, like they'll take like a mindful walk and they'll really pay attention to like how their feet feel as they're touching the ground, and they'll pay attention to like the sights and the sounds around them and things like that. Or it can be like being mindful while you're doing an activity. So like if you're washing dishes or something like that, just really paying attention to the process and what you're doing. That's something that I absolutely do not like to do. So, but I usually just try to get it over with as fast as I can. But mindfulness would be the opposite of that, right? Like really paying attention to the process, like to what you're doing, like how the water feels, like what the task is, and really focusing on that. Because you probably can't see the picture, but this picture is says on the left, it says mindful, and then on the right, it says mindful. So they're two different words, but what do you notice about the picture? Can you see that? So on the left, that one, the person's got their mind full, right? Like their mind is full, they're thinking about everything. And then on the right, it's very peaceful and serene, right? So the idea is that with mindfulness, our brains naturally are always either thinking about the past, right? Like thinking about what I did today, what I did yesterday, what I said that I shouldn't have said, you know, whatever. Or they're thinking about the future. What's on my to-do list? What do I have to do tomorrow? What do I have to do tonight? If we just kind of let our mind naturally go, that's what happens. But mindfulness is really a process of paying attention in the present moment. Like, this is what I am doing right now. This is how my body feels right now. And trying not to think about those things in the past or future. And so, like I said, it could be, like, while you're doing an activity, like, just paying really close attention. Or it could be, like, a more formal thing, like meditation or yoga or something like that. And the idea is not to be judgmental about it, but just to, like, use a scientist mindset and just be curious, right? Like, just be curious. Like, what am I experiencing in the present moment? And so, and like I've said before, like by being aware of what's really going on, then you can decide, like, am I liking what I'm doing? Is this serving me? Or do I want to do something different? So how does this relate to food and eating? I just talked about mindfulness in general, but mindful eating is really using those same principles of paying attention, but paying attention to the eating process. So paying attention to everything, all aspects of eating. We talked about like the study I talked about with the French people, right? Like if we think, I mean, I don't know, I've never been to France, but when I imagine France, I imagine like going to a dinner with like flowers on the table and like a cute cafe on a sidewalk, right? And so it's like the environment, like paying attention to everything, the environment, like the atmosphere, like, and the food and like the presentation of the food and things like that. So just really paying attention to what you're doing and eating with all of your senses. And then paying attention to how you feel while you're eating. So tuning into those hunger and fullness cues. You know, paying attention to the food. Is this something I really like? Do I even like this flavor? Is this something I enjoy? Is this making my stomach hurt? You know, is this something that's not settling with me? So just really paying attention. Noticing any thoughts you have. Like, you know, I'm ready to be done with this. I'm ready for the next thing or something like that. And then, like I said, also just like in a non-judgmental way, recognizing if you're eating for those head hunger cues, like things that are not physical hunger. Here's another definition of mindful eating. So basically, eating on purpose. So when you're physically hungry, to nourish your body, to use the food as fuel, and eating to have more not to improve your energy when your body really needs fuel. And then it's eating with awareness. So being present during eating, minimizing those distractions, really focusing on the food, focusing on the eating experience, paying attention to tastes and textures and things. And like I said before, using hunger and fullness cues. So I think I had a note earlier and I didn't go over it, but in talking about distractions, can any of you think of, we talked a little bit about like eating at work, but can any of you think about other ideas of things, like what are some other things that distract us when we eat? Or maybe reasons that we would be distracted when we're eating?
Thinking about what we have to do as soon as we're done.
Yes.
Yes.
Right.
Check your steps on phones and different things like that. So you get
get 1 point if you get 7,500 steps each day, and you get 2 points if you get 10,000 steps each day. For most people, 10,000 steps is between 4 and 5 miles. Don't wait until the very end to try to get them. Most of us aren't good enough to do that. Yeah, so the 10 push-ups, and these three, I'll stay. 10 push-ups. If you have shoulder problems or you can't do regular push-ups, you're welcome to do wall push-ups. Just stand against the wall and do push-ups. We're just trying to strengthen those muscles. Or you can do it like on the table so that you don't have the full weight if you need to build up to that. And you don't have to do them all at once. You can do two, wait an hour, do two more. That's one of the things we tested at the first, if you remember, was your push-ups. So we're going to work on that. So then the next challenge will change every single week. The first one is to wear your seatbelt every time you're in a vehicle. If you don't, if you forget for just a minute, then you don't get a point for that day. Okay? On the second week, it's to record two things you're grateful for each day, and you need to write these down someplace. You don't have, you can put them on the back of this sheet. You can put them in your phone, wherever, but you need to write them down and just consciously think of things you're grateful for. And that's just for the week, okay? Week three is to floss your teeth every day. Brushing and flossing teeth is part of a really good health. They have linked poor dental hygiene to heart conditions. Week four is to do one act of service each day. You get to choose what that is. Serve somebody, do something for someone else. The next one, week five, no fast food, including soda, for the entire week. We're doing it for a week. Let's see if you can make it through the week and see how you feel about it. The last one, and this one tends to be hard for a lot of us, is to limit your screen time to 2 hours a day. So if you're working at a computer, that doesn't count.
Okay.
But if you're at home and you're watching TV for 4 hours a day, that's probably a little too many. Or if you're on your phone or you're on Facebook or social media or anything like that, 2 hours. Less, 2 hours or less. Questions about any of those? Do they make sense? If you're reading a book, that's different. You're not a, I mean, it's a book, right? and then the last one we have is your challenge of choice. And I ask you in the last time you replied, what is something you want to work on? What is something personally that you think will help you? If you're still struggling with, I can't get enough water, you can go back and you can do the water. If you want to do the meditation one again, you can do the meditation one again. If you have one you want to do, 1 year I had someone that wanted to quit smoking, and so they actually quit smoking. You know, if you want a better relationship, because that's part of health and wellness, I had 1 year, someone said, I'm going to say something nice to my husband every single day. But it has to be something you can do every single day. And I hear a lot, well, I want to do this better, or I want to eat less sugar. That doesn't mean anything to me. It needs to be specific. What does less sugar mean? It's just like saying I want to sleep more. I don't know what that means. Sleep 7 to 9 hours. I understand that. So you need to come up with something that's really specific that you can do every single day. And it needs to go the whole 6 weeks. Okay. So questions, ideas?
Is this the last one?
This is the last one. Mm-hmm. And it ends right about the first, the end of May, and then we'll meet right after that, the first week in June, to do our final prizes and awards. And we normally, and you guys can tell me what you'd want to do. In the past, we've done a 5K, if someone's interested in doing a 5K. It's never been super competitive. There's been a few that are one or two that are competitive. But a lot of people will do just to say, hey, I did a 5K, and I finished it. Last year we did a hike instead of a 5K. So if you'd rather do a hike, we can do a hike. And we actually went up to the big tree. And Janelle went, and Yeah, we had it. It was really nice. So be thinking about it. If you'd rather do a 5K or we'll put together a little hike that we go on as a group. Because that's pretty fun. So questions about this? So Monday I will send you an email and I will ask you to tell me what your healthy, your challenging choice is. And if it's not specific, I might send you an email back and say, because I had someone say, I want to run further. And I'm like, yeah, that's not going to work for me. I'll party on the run. Because you can't, yeah, it has to be nurtured. Thank you so much for coming. If you didn't get your rebate and I owe you one steak and we'll get you that.